Assalamualaikum dan salam sejahtera. Selamat pagi diucapkan kepada semua yang menonton sesi webinar pada pagi ini, sama ada yang menonton melalui Webex ataupun menerusi Facebook Apps. Bertemu kembali kita di dalam sesi webinar Bicara Pakar UIRL 2021. Saya Ahmad Muslehuddin bin Sarun, selaku moderator, mewakili Pusat Pengurusan Makmal Universiti UTM Johor Bahru, ingin mengucapkan selamat datang dan terima kasih kepada semua penonton kerana dapat bersama meluangkan masa menonton sesi perkongsian ilmu dalam sesi webinar Bicara Pakar UIRL 2021 pada pagi ini. Untuk makluman semua, sesi webinar ini diadakan secara bersiri dengan melibatkan penceramah yang telah dilantik dalam kalangan ahli akademik dan penyelidik UTM sebagai pakar bidang di Mahkamah Pusat UIRL. Oleh yang demikian, seperti yang dijanjikan pada hari ini, 30 hari bulan Ogos 2021, slot keempat sesi webinar Bicara Pakar UIRL 2021 akan berkongsi ilmu yang sangat menarik yang bertajuk High Resolution Transmission Electron Microscope HRTEM Sample Preparation by Using Focused Ion Beam FIB. Baiklah. Sebelum itu, saya ingin mengalu-alukan kehadiran penceramah kita pada pagi ini selaku pakar bidang di Makmal Imaging dan Mikroskopi UIRL, iaitu Dr. Mohd Zamri bin Mohd Yusop, selaku pensyarah kanan di Sekolah Kejuruteraan Mekanikal Fakulti Kejuruteraan UTM Johor Bahru. Jutaan terima kasih diucapkan kepada Dr. Mohd Zamri Mohd Yusop kerana sudi meluangkan masa untuk berkongsi ilmu dan pengalaman kepada kita semua pada pagi ini. Untuk makluman penonton yang dikasihi sekalian, sesi webinar ini akan berlangsung selama 1 jam dan selepas itu akan diadakan sesi soal jawab. Tuan-tuan boleh kemukakan atau mengajukan soalan di ruangan komen yang disediakan pada aplikasi Webex ataupun di Facebook Live dan saya akan bacakan soalan-soalan tersebut kepada penceramah nanti. Dan untuk makluman juga kepada para penonton, link kehadiran bagi mata CPD UTM akan diletakkan di ruangan komen selepas 30 minit sesi webinar ini berlangsung dan diharapkan agar semua penonton dapat terus setia bersama kami sehingga tamat sesi webinar ini. Baiklah, sebelum saya menyerahkan pentas maya ini kepada penceramah kita, marilah kita sama-sama mengenali terlebih dahulu secara ringkas latar belakang penceramah yang ada bersama kita pada pagi ini, iaitu Dr. Mohd Zamri bin Mohd Yusop. Merupakan seorang pensyarah kanan di Jabatan Kejuruteraan Bahan, Pembuatan dan Industri Sekolah Kejuruteraan Mekanikal, Fakulti Kejuruteraan UTM Johor Bahru. Beliau telah memperoleh ijazah Dr. Falsafah PhD di Nagoya Institute of Technology NITEC di Nagoya, Jepun pada tahun 2013 dalam bidang Frontier Materials. Seterusnya, beliau telah meneruskan pengajian dan penyelidikan di peringkat postdoc sehingga tahun 2015 under New Energy and Industrial Technology Development Organization Japan Fellowship, juga di NITEC, Nagoya, Jepun, dan kemudian beliau telah kembali ke Malaysia dan menjadi pensyarah kanan di UTM Johor Bahru pada tahun 2015 dan beliau juga kini merupakan Research Fellow di Advanced Membrane Technology Research and Tech Center iaitu MTech di UTM Johor Bahru. Dan terkini beliau telah memiliki lebih daripada 70 International Scientific Index ISI publications dan telah mempunyai 16 H Index publications. Antara kepakaran dan bidang penyelidikan beliau adalah dalam bidang graphene synthesis, carbon nanotube, nanofiber synthesis, field emission related application, in situ scanning electron microscope, transmission electron microscope, carbon nanostructured based electronic dan juga surface modification by using ion irradiation technique. Baiklah, tanpa membuang masa lagi, saya ingin menjemput Dr. Mohd Zamri bin Mohd Yusop untuk memulakan sesi perkongsian ilmu beliau. Dengan segala hormatnya, dipersilakan.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and good morning everybody. Happy Independence Day for all Malaysian. Okay, so for today, I would like to present about this title, High Resolution Transmission Electron Microscope Sample Preparation Using Focused Ion Beam. And for today's talk, actually, I will explain about the function of FIB, and then the process that we can that we need to use. The process that we need to do lah to fabricate the sample for HRTEM. Okay, just now Musladin already present about my background. So basically, I'm graduate from Nagoya Institute of Technology. I've been there for more than 11 years, and this is my supervisor, Prof. Masaki Tanimura. Okay, so he taught me a lot about the nanotechnology and allow me to use a lot of very advanced instrument, SEM, TEM, and also in this in his lab lah, we have developed very interesting research project, which is using in situ to study about nanomaterials. So today, so I'm glad because my junior Dr. Yazid Yaakob also joined us in this webinar. Okay, he currently in NITEC lah, doing his postdoc. Okay. So that's all about me. Okay, so first I would like to explain about the list of webinar series that I've been do for our unit, microscopy and imaging. Okay, so for the past 4 years, so we have prepared a few series of seminar. So first we have the sample preparation for transmission electron microscope seminar. So this seminar actually for the first year postgraduate student, because this seminar is very basic to support the student to understand about their sample and how they can prepare the sample for TM analysis. So most for this seminar, we focus on the powder type of sample, organic and inorganic type of materials. And then next, we have the second seminar. So we will repeat this seminar again and again through the year. Okay. So we have the post-analysis for transmission electron microscope seminar. So this one actually to support the student who doesn't know how to handle the digital data from the Gatan microscopy suite. Okay, so we'll focus to use the GMS 3.0. So with this seminar, we'll help student to understand how they can measure the lasting distance, how they can change the size of the image, and how they can set up the scale for their image. And then we have another seminar, which is more on theoretical and basic operation of TM. So this one focus on more fundamental knowledge about the TM, and also very advanced processing image for the GMS 3.0. So from this seminar, actually, we will teach students how to process their image, because in this seminar, we will teach student how to, or researcher, how to process their image, because sometimes when you get the digital data of the TM, that digital data contains of noise which will affect the image of the TM. So we'll help student to reduce the noise from the digital data so that they can get a better image. Later I will show to you a sample of the very good digital data after the noise canceller lah. And for today seminar, actually we focus on the HRTEM sample preparation using focus ion wave. This is one of the instrument that we have in the URL. So we want to promote about this instrument, and we hope that more student or researcher will use our system here in URL. Okay, so this is the outline of the of my webinar today. So we start with the introduction about the microscope, electron microscopy for material analysis, and then we'll go to about the focus ion beam, structure of FIB, and then structure of dual beam microscopy, which we have in the URL. And then about the what is the suitable sample for FIB, and finally introduction about our system at the URL. So this is the same slide I've been used for I think more than 5 years since I start to give the talk about the RTM. Okay, so basically when we want to understand about the material, we need to understand about the properties of the material. So one of the most simple tool to understand about the material is microscope. Okay, so from the microscope, actually, we will understand about the structure, the properties of the material. So first, obviously, when you become as a researcher, okay, you start to develop different type of material or doping or making any type of system. Okay, so we do understand about the processing, but to enhance or to improve the properties of the material, we need to understand about the structure of the material. So to understand about the structure, first, maybe the most simple one, if you do research related on alloy, maybe you need to understand about the grain structure. So this is an example of the grain structure of the metals. Okay, and then if you in the biological field, maybe you need to understand about the structure of this cell or any. So this one you can use fluorescence cell, fluorescence camera lah, microscope, sorry, to observe the about the biological sample. So from understanding the structure, you will understand about the properties of the material, and from there you will able to improve or enhance the performance of the system or the material that you prepare. So microscope is one of the very important tools in the research. And then this the optical microscope and the transmission electron microscope, they have a different system. However, their function actually almost same, which is to observe very small material. Okay, for example, for optical microscope, we can observe maybe, I think nowadays, maybe can observe up to 10,000 magnification. So from we can observe grain structure for metallic material. Okay, and if we want to use the transmission electron microscope, actually we can observe, I think currently it can go up to 15 million magnification by using STEM. Sorry, 15 or 20 million magnification by using STEM. Okay, so at that kind or at that level of magnification, actually we can observe up to the atomic level. And for the most update TM, which we also have in the URL, okay, we have ARMS 2000F. Okay, this TM equipped with the STEM, which we can observe actually at the atomic scale, and we can observe atom lah, so very very high magnification. So the structure of the optical microscope basically is almost similar to the transmission microscope. For example, if we twist the optical microscope, okay, so at this part here is the illumination system, which for the optical microscope will be the visible light, and for the transmission electron microscope will be the electron source. Okay, it can be cold cathode or it can be hit by field emission cold cathode or by the filament. Okay, and then we have the sample stage for the optical microscope. Sample stage will be at here, and then for the transmission electron microscope, the sample stage will be at this section lah. And then we have the lenses. Okay, so for the optical microscope, normally you will use glass, and for the TM, normally you will use electromagnetic lenses. And finally, at this part will be the camera. So for the normal optical microscope, normally you will use the nowadays most of the optical microscope are equipped with digital camera, and for TM also most of the new type of TM, they are also equipped with the digital camera. But when I was in Japan in NITEC, when I learned TM, I used the film. So to process the film after you finish your observe your sample, it will take another 2 or 3 days lah. But nowadays the sample processing is very very advanced, very simple, and actually very helpful lah for us. Okay, so this is the graph that I would like to show share with you. Okay, how we can identify what kind of information we want to obtain from our sample. So basically, this is a list of the analysis that we can do with our sample, depend on what kind of information we want to study. However, from this image, you need to understand that not sample can use all the analysis equipment, because some sample, for example, if your sample is about layers using how to say, using the deformation coating with have a few type of layers. So maybe your analysis will focus on this. For example, you need to do the FIB to check about the layers, and then you need to do the TM to study about the bonding. Sorry, not bonding. The doping or so on. But if you sample only focus on the surface related of study, maybe you only need to use the surface analysis. For example, Auger, SPS, TOFSIM, FTIR, EDX, or Raman. So it still depend on your material. So as a researcher, as a student, okay, you need to understand properly about your sample first before you start to do the analysis for your sample. Okay, so you need to understand what kind of sample and which type of element inside the sample, and from that actually you can start to do the much more detailed analysis. For example, TM, because TM actually already focused study on the very detailed information. Okay, so this is a list of chemical analysis roadmap that you can use to check about what kind of information you prefer to obtain from your sample. Okay, this one later I will explain, because I just want to show this one to help you that you need to fully understand about the sample before you start to do the analysis. Okay, this one normally I will share with the sample preparation webinar. So please join later lah if you want to get more information about this roadmap. Okay, so now we back to our topic for today. What is focus ion beam? Okay, so this is one not a very new machine, but it's quite old. However, it only focus on the specific type of material. So first, we need to understand what type of system built inside the FIB. So for to use FIB, first we need to have SEM, because even though FIB can stand alone, but it still require SEM to support the process. Later I will explain why. Okay, so about the SEM, I think this is one of the most simple system that we can find in any universities or any research center. Okay, so it's basically the basic concept of the electron bombard on the material, okay, on the surface of the material, and from there the secondary electron or the backscatter electron will be collected from the detector, and then from there it will give us the result. Okay, from the software and the digital information, it will process, then it will give us the result. Basically, it's scanning the sample like this image lah, and it will give us the result in few seconds. In milliseconds. That's why we can directly observe the image of our sample. So for SEM, the system is almost similar to the optical microscope. Okay, so we have the illumination. The source of illumination for optical microscope is light microscope. For the SEM, we have the either the filament or the cold cathode. And then it should have the lens lah. It can be glass lens or it can be condensed lens lah. And then this is the sample area. So from this system, actually, it's almost similar to the optical microscope. Okay, and from the SEM result, actually, we can obtain normally about the morphology information about our sample. And then in the FIB SEM system, it should have nanomanipulator. So what the uses of the nanomanipulator? Actually, the uses of nanomanipulator is to transfer the lamella. Later on, after we cut the sample, we need to transfer the lamella to the grid. So the nanomanipulator actually one of the very important parts in the FIB SEM system. So in this image, you can see a fixed nanomanipulator, and with the samples stage which can be rotate lah. Okay, but okay. So this is example of the nanomanipulator that we have in NITEC, Nagoya Institute of Technology. This is the same image I took, I think, last 10 years when I was in master. Okay, so this is nanoprobe, can be controlled using piezoelectric, and this one is the sample of carbon fiber. So here you can understand that from the nanoprobe, actually we can touch the very small sample, and we can fully control the nanoprobe in very precise scale. For example, for this SEM, I think last time it can move, I think, around 100 nano step. So it's quite big lah. But for FIB, it will use much more advanced nanomanipulator. So this is the brand that normally equipped with the FIB system. So next, in the FIB system, it should have the FIB itself. So what is FIB? FIB actually is a focused energetic ion beam that used to remove material or to create any shape on the, at the nanoscale position. Okay, so when ion with a very high energy bombard into any materials, okay, it will cause a sputtered jetted atom lah. So from here, actually, we can produce a lot of shape from the FIB from this phenomenon. Okay, and basically the FIB were developed due to the how to say when in the industry start to have a problem to study about the defect or faults in their semiconductor device. So it start maybe around 1970 or 1980. So it's quite old technology. Okay. And then to have a FIB, we need to have the focused ion beam optics system. So this one we call as the liquid metal ion source. So for the FIB optics, for the liquid metal ion source, normally it will use gallium. Why? Because for gallium, it have a low melting point. Okay, and then he has very high mass and low volatility, and normally it not related with other elements because it's quite rare lah for researcher to use gallium as one of their doping and so on. So it won't affect the sample much. Okay, and then the concept is by using ion emission. I will explain later in the next slide. And normally for the focused ion beam optics, it will use around 500 to 330K electron volt. So it's quite high lah compared to the normal field emission. So, and then the beam of the optical for the ion beam actually can be controlled by using the aperture size, different aperture size. And by controlling different aperture size, we can obtain very sharp beam, and from there actually we can control to create very small shape or size in the sample, depend how we want to do the milling or how we can do the welding and so on. So this is the how the liquid metal ion source works. Okay, first they will have a tungsten needle in this device, and then covered with the heating coil, and then a metal reservoir. This one is should be the gallium. Okay, and then suppressor and contractor electrodes. Okay, so as I mentioned previously, gallium mostly used because there will be no alloy also with the tungsten, because tungsten will be the source of the filament. Okay, so if there's no alloy formation with the gallium, then it should be okay lah. And then also gallium have low melting point and also low vapor pressure. So the concept is of the ion emission actually using combination between field ionization and field evaporation. So when they hit the tungsten here, okay, so the gallium will move to the tip of the filament here. Okay, so it will create, we call as a telecon that form the wetting tungsten tip lah. And then from there, by using the field evaporation, okay, from the extractor, it will push the ion towards the column lah. And this ion will bombard to the material that we want to observe or we want to mill. Okay. Okay, and then another system that required in the FIB is the gas injection system. So for the gas injection system, actually it the uses of the GIS is really to deliver or and control the flow of gas to the sample surface to interact with the ion beam, or it can be also electron beam. And then from there, we can have two different case. Okay, for example, case number one is for material deposition. For example, if we want to do the welding process, or if we want to do the coating process, okay, it can help to do the material deposition. Or another case is to enhance or to etch, to prefer etching. So it will supply a gas that when interact with the ion or the electron beam, it will enhance the etching process. So this process is two different process lah. Okay, so this is the image. Okay, So first is it will supply the platinum rich gas, and then when this gas interact with the electron beam or gamma beam, okay, the platinum will deposit here lah, at this area. Or for the etching process, when they bombard with the ion beam here, okay, it will supply with the etched gas injection. So this gas also will help to enhance the etching process. So this is two different process that can be supported by the GIS. Okay, and then we need to understand what are the difference between the ion beam and the electron beams. Okay, so for example, when electron beams bombard on any metals, okay, it will produce a few different result. First, it will produce secondary electrons, and then it will produce backscattered electrons, and then you can produce the X-ray, cathodoluminescent, and auger electrons. Normally, for SEM, we will use the secondary electrons and backscattered electrons for imaging. And then maybe for the analytical measurement, we will use the backscattered electron for EBSD, depend if we equip with the EBSD. And also we will use the X-ray for the EDS analysis. So this is the most common thing that we use in the SEM machine. But for the ion beam, there will be slightly different result. When ion bombard on the metals, it will produce a few different results. First, it will produce secondary electrons. So from the secondary electrons, as similar to the SEM, it can be used for the imaging. And then number two, it will produce sputtered ejected ions or atom. This one normally to etch the sample. So this is the most common thing happen when ion beam bombard to the metals. And then number three, if we can produce dislocation or vacancy to the material structure. Number four, due to the heat generated from the ion bombardment on the atoms, okay, it will sometimes will create a polymerization, which means that the phase of the material might be changed due to the ion beam. And finally, when this ion lose its energy, okay, it will embed depth in the certain area. So this one normally they will use to calculate the range of projection for the ion beam. So it can use to measure, to estimate the depth of the etching when you use the ion beam. So this is example image of the SIM, which is for the scanning ion beam, and for SEM, for scanning electron microscope. Okay, so this one is two different results. First, from the SIM, for example, if you want to compare between the SEM image, here you can see that with the coating sample, okay. For SEM, normally for epoxy, you have no problem. Epoxy is example sample with non-conductive sample, okay, you have no problem, you still can observe. But with coating with the osmium here, epoxy also can be observed using SEM. However, if the sample is not coated, which means that the epoxy is fully non-conductive, okay, in the SIM, the image will be different. Okay, so the non-conductive normally it will produce much more darker image. This is because that the gallium source actually is positive. The gallium source actually is negative, and the non-conductive normally is charged with a positive charge. So all the negative ion will just go to the positive charge. So it will be neutral. That's why it cannot produce much light. That's why for the non-conductive, the image will be different. So this is very important because, for example, if your sample is mixture between conductive and non-conductive material, and then when you observe your sample using SEM, and at the same time when you do FIB, obviously you will use the SIM also. So you will observe two different image, even though the sample actually same. This is because of the two different phenomenon between electron beam and ion beam. So you need to understand about this concept. Next is that about the destruction of the ion beam. Okay, actually when ion beam bombard on the sample, it will produce, it will damage the sample surface. So this image here, you can see that here is the SEM image. And here is in the blue region, here is the SIM image. So when SIM bombard to the sample, it will change the sample morphology, which means that the sum of the sample facet will be changed lah. So it will destroy the sample. So you need to understand that when you do the FIB, make sure to reduce the uses of the SIM as much as possible, because it will change your sample faces or sample properties. So this is another example, okay, when we observe, for example, the stainless steel under FIB. So when it exposed more than 3 minutes, actually it caused a transformation between arsenide into ferrite, okay, from the arsenic stainless steel. So for example, for in the arsenic stainless steel, the structure of the alloy is in, it's not actually arsenide, because it should be in at room temperature, it should be ferrite or cementite. But when it consists of a very high amount of carbon, okay, the structure is almost similar to the arsenide structure. So that's why they explain like this lah. Okay, sometimes if we expose too much, too long, okay, it might can change to martensite, okay, because the different temperature of the stainless steel, the cooling rate, okay, when the cooling rate is very fast enough, then it will change to martensite. If the cooling rate is slightly slow, then it will change to ferrite. So depend on the temperature of the inside the SEM. Okay, so next we need to understand about the structure of the dual beam microscope system. So sometimes they call as FIB SEM. Okay, so in the FIB SEM, normally it will consist of the cell, and then it also consists of the FIB. So both system, FIB and SEM, will be targeted at the same area here. Okay, and combine the uses of these two system, okay, we can use for imaging, etching, milling, and deposition on this on the sample. And some, it also consists of detectors. Okay, detectors, we have few detectors. Some of the detectors maybe EDS, which is very common for SEM, and also ABSD. And then it also consists of the gas injection system. So this one actually to deliver the reactive gas for the deposition or etching process. And finally, it will consist of the nanomanipulator. So this one normally the nanomanipulator is a tungsten nanoprobe, okay, work to lift out or to move sample lah from the our bulk sample to the TEM grid later in the process. So the dual beam microscope normally are controlled in high precision navigation, which means that the degrees between the FIB and the SEM is as mostly a fixed, depend on the supplier. Some depend for our, in our case in UIRL, our system I think 52 degrees, but in some model or SEM, they use I think 54. So it range around 50 to 60 degrees. And these two beam could be controlled with the very precise navigation, because the movement of the beam must be controlled up to nanoscale, because we want to make a lamella, right? For lamella, it will be a very, very thin structure, maybe with thickness around 100 nanometer. And the sample stage normally can be rotated. Okay, so what are the suitable sample for the FIB? Okay, so for FIB, it's more site specific of micro and nano patterning, which means that the sample is very specific. So there are a few applications that we can use for FIB. First is for modification of IC or semiconductor, where we can create a cross section to study about defect, or we can modify the IC. Okay, so it can also use to cutting the sample, depend on our research lah. Okay, and then another application for FIB is to make a TEM lamella. So this is more on specific application, which is for TEM. And for TEM lamella also, as I present just now, right? When you want to cut the sample, it will use the ion beam. So when we use the ion beam, if the sample is low melting point sample, it cannot tolerate with the ion beam. So the sample will be, how to say, the sample will be fixed with maybe semiconductor or solid metallic sample. Okay, so in my opinion lah, the best suitable sample for FIB is maybe limited to semiconductor or solid metallic sample. Okay. So this is the current FIB facilities in our lab in URL. Okay, so we are using the Zeiss cross beam 340 system. And if you have any inquiries about the system or you want to use our machine, you can contact lah the PIC, Mr. Ahmad Muslihuddin. Okay, you can email him or you can call. Okay. So next is we move to the process of FIB. Okay, so before you can prepare the sample for the TEM sample, okay, first we need to understand that the sample must be coated with the platinum layer coating. In our case also, we use platinum layer. It can be a different type of coating, but I think most of the machine, they use either platinum or carbon, either one. Okay, so in this case, normally we need to coat the platinum. So this platinum can support the lamella because lamella later will be very, very thin, maybe around 100 nanometer. So if our sample, for example, if our sample is very, very hard sample, but when we slice the sample up to the 100 nanometer, it will become very, very fragile. That's why we required, we need to put the platinum protection lah, to support the sample. And next, we will do the trench milling. So in this process, okay, at the targeted area here, for example, and then we'll do the milling process lah. So the milling process depend on the targeted area, and normally it will be quite thick compared to the actual interest area. For example, the interest area will be around 100 nano, but when we do the trench milling, maybe we will leave around 500 nanometer lah. So it will be much more thicker because later we need to the edge do the edge process lah. Okay, when we do the trench milling, it will require to use a very high voltage and high current. So in this case, as I mentioned earlier, it might change the properties of the sample. So if the sample cannot be tolerated with very high temperature, so maybe the later product will be not the accurate lah, not very precise. Okay, then after we do the milling, we need to do the U-cut. So this U-cut actually to separate the sample, the lamella from the bulk sample. Okay, so in this image, you can see that when they do the U-cut here, we cut at the bottom area. Okay, and then only the sample will only support at this part. Next is the most difficult process lah in the FIB system. So in this process, we need to leave out the sample. So to leave out the sample, we need to use the nanoprobe, and this nanoprobe must touch the lamella. Okay, must touch the lamella. So this process is very, very difficult, even though in this video, you can see it's like a very simple process, but I've been in the research using Institute SEM and also Institute TEM. So this process is very, very difficult because in the SEM, it's very hard for us to understand about the similar focal point of sample. For example, now we have two different focus, okay? First focus at the probe, another focus at the lamella. So in this focus, in this case, actually, we need to make sure that the tip of the nanoprobe is exactly same height with the lamella here. So this is very challenging process. So actually, it require a lot of training. Okay. After we attach the probe with the lamella, then we need to cut the sample. So after we cut the sample, then we need to move the sample to the TEM grid. So this example of the TEM grid. Okay, we will move the lamella to the TEM grid, and then we will do the welding process lah to attach the lamella with the TEM grid. Okay, so this process also quite difficult because you need to make sure that the lamella is properly attached at the edge of the TEM grid. So normally you need to understand about the focus, understand how to manage the focus of the SEM lah. Okay. And then after we finish do the transfer process on the temp grid, so this is the final process. Okay, the final process is to do the thinning process of the lamella up to the 100. This is standard thickness, 100 nanometer thickness. But in my opinion, it's better if we can do up to 50 nanometer. It's quite challenging. It still depend on the skill of the microscopist lah. But it's better to have much more thinner lah, around 50 nanometer. But most of but for the standard, they will use 100 nanometer. Okay, but depend eh. If your sample is very good, maybe you can do up to 50 nanometer. Okay, so this process is to make sure that the lamella will be electron transparent. So that when we observe under the transmission electron microscope, we can study the atomic structure in detail. It's much more clear without any problem. So about the lamella position, okay, there are various design of temp grid. So this is the most common setup of temp grid. Some temp grid use the normal temp grid, which is the nano grid. Okay, we can put the lamella in various position here or here, but in my opinion, okay, the best position should be at the most thin area at the edge of the grid. So in this position, I think this is maybe the best example instead of this one. Okay, because when we do the TEM, very thick area, for example this area, okay, it will produce like a shadow to the sample later, so it'll be very hard for us lah to focus at the very thin area with the beam only focus at this area, so it will give a shadow, so it interfere the electron movement lah of the TM. So it's good to put maybe at this area or at the edge of this area, or this is the best example lah, image that I share with you. Okay. So this is one of the technique lah that you need to understand when you prepare the lamella for the TEM. So this is example of the sample prepared by FIB. Okay, so in this example, okay, prepared by Skepper, published in Ultra Microscopy in 2012. Okay, so he prepared a CrSi2 layer on the silicon wafer prepared by FIB, and the sample thinness from the yield result, okay, it showed that the thickness is around 25 nanometer. So which means that the sample very, very thin. And from the low magnification image here, you can see that a few layers of the sample. Here is the PT, is the support layers. And then carbon, this one normally generated during the coating, during the deposition process, okay, amorphous carbon. And then this one is the actual sample, CrAS2, and the best substrate, which is silicon 110. So at the C image here, you can see that between CrAS2 here and the silicon, okay, it consists no defect at all, which means that the sample, the preparation using FIB didn't cause any problem to the sample, which means that it's perfect, okay, because silicon sample should be very, very, how to say, smooth, right? So it shows no difference at all. And then for the stem image, okay, angle annular dark field image here, you can see that some area here at the silicon layer, they can they can see that the twinning on the silicon atom. Okay, so this is another example lah, product that not product result that we can observe by using FIB. If we use the, for example, ion milling. So ion slicing machine may be quite difficult to obtain this kind of result lah. But for FIB it will be very, very simple, very, very easy lah to get this kind of result. And obviously this image also, as I mentioned earlier, right, you can see that the image is very, very clear and so on, right? But actually this image also, I think, have been done with the noise canceller, so that's why you can see like the atom very clear. Okay, so this is an example of the sample that prepared by FIB. Then what are the result that we can expect lah from the FIB machine? So that's all for today about my presentation. Okay, so now maybe we will start with the Q&A session.
Terima kasih diucapkan kepada Dr. Mohd Zamri Mohd Yusop atas penerangan dan perkongsian ilmu yang telah diberikan tadi. Okay, seterusnya kita akan pergi ke sesi question and answer. Okay, ada tiga soalan di ruangan komen chat di Webex. Okay, soalan pertama, doktor. Can FIB or SIM provide higher contrast and clearer image to the differentiate the conductive and non-conductive region in a carbon nanotube ceramic sample? Okay, itu soalan pertama.
Okay, saya jawab dulu. Okay, so about this question. Okay, first, carbon nanotube should be a conductive material. And for example, if you mix with the non-conductive material, for example, just now the question is the support, right? Support of the CNT is non-conductive.
Can FIB provide higher contrast and clear image?
It depends. For example, if the non-conductive region is much more bigger compared to the conductive region, maybe the image will become very, very dark. But if the non-conductive is not at very, the region is very small, then you can get a very high contrast. But it still depends on the other type of element. For example, if you use a lot of element in your sample, you dope with, for example, tungsten, for example, heavy metals. Okay, heavy metal also will produce low contrast, darker image to the sample. So for SIM image, if you use heavy metal or if you use non-conductive, the image will be very, very dark. So maybe it cannot give a very good image lah. And then if the non-conductive, for example, if you use polymer and that non-conductive is not very stable, then you only have a few minutes to capture the image before the material will be changed into something that very, very bad image lah, formation. There'll be phase transformation lah for that type of polymer.
Okay, maafkan saya tadi, saya lupa nak sebut nama yang tanya tadi. Soalan tadi daripada Ka Fei Chan. Okay, soalan kedua daripada Ka Fei Chan. He asked, can FIB milling apply in ceramic composite?
Actually, yes. Yeah. For ceramic composite, we can use the FIB milling. No problem.
And then number three, will the FIB or SIM cause damage into the surface of the carbon nanotube or graphene composite?
Okay, this one depend on the, for example, graphene or CNT. Actually, for graphene, it should be very, very, robust, because the melting point for graphene should be around 3000 Celsius. So it should be very stable. But if you functionalize your graphene, which means that the graphene is not pure, or you using the graphene oxide, so maybe it will change the structure of the graphene. Another thing is that, for example, for FIB and so on, okay, if you want to measure the graphene structure, it's good to use the normal preparation, which means that if you use graphene, it in composite, right? So it's not in the actual graphene, which is graphene domain, which is graphene sheet. So maybe if you choose FIB, maybe it's not very accurate measurement, because the graphene should be observed directly without any sub post treatment process of the FIB, because FIB will change lah the structure of the graphene, because graphene is very thin. When you expose with very high ion beam, maybe it will become wrinkled, maybe it will agglomerate. Okay, so it start like a sheet of paper. Then when you focus with very high energy, it will start to agglomerate. because it should be very, very flexible.
Okay, thank you, Doctor. Next question from the Iman Apsi. Iman Apsi asks, are SEM or TEM considered as disruptive or non-disruptive testing?
Okay, the only disruptive technique is the SIM. For SEM, no, but depend on sample. If your sample is polymer type of sample, polymer composite or so on, we can assume as disruptive analysis lah, because it will, how to say, it will change the morphology of the sample if exposed with the beam too long lah. So depend on sample, but generally TEM is not disruptive. It's only the last, how to say, the last analytical system, which means that after you finish do SRD, maybe EDX, maybe FTR or so on, TEM is the last one. Not, don't start with TEM. It's not disruptive, but don't start with TEM. Okay.
Okay. Next question from Sumiati. She asks, Doctor, is it possible to make a trench on a single mode optical fiber with dimension 3 micron times 10 millimeter and the depth kedalamannya is 50 micrometer?
This one I think most you should answer lah, because you the one who will conduct the machine. I think it should be possible, but what's the precision that our system most?
It's a means the kedalaman dia 50 micron eh. By using possible, the FIB. Right? FIB, I think it is not suitable for the orang kata apa?
Thickness.
Dia punya kedalaman tu tak sesuai
depth,
lah.
Depth. Okay, depth to depth lah.
Because FIB is for the nano structure. It's not suitable for the kedalaman terlalu that ni terlalu apa panjang
I
sangat.
I think few micron should be possible lah. 5 micron is possible.
5 micron is okay.
50 is too much lah, I think. Yeah, 5 micron, 5 to 10 should be okay. Yeah.
Okay. From Adiba Shakri, Doctor, is it better resolution to use FIB for organic samples? For example, see the internalization of the metal inside the cell.
Oh, okay. If cell, I don't recommend using FIB lah. Because it will, how to say, destroy the cell lah. Because when you use FIB, the ion actually can generate very high heat. Okay. Just now I give example. For example, from stainless steel, right? From arsenic structure, it will change to ferrite. This formation normally occur for bulk material. The temperature should be around, I think, 600 to 800 Celsius. So just assume your sample lah exposed with that kind of temperature lah. So I don't think that for organic sample will be, how to say, good for FIB. If the temperature will be very high, then you will change your sample faces lah or something.
Okay, next question from Dr. Siti Rahmat Aid. Okay, she asks, can URL have a two-step deposition technique for protective layer that involve soft deposition? Okay.
I think maybe you can answer this question.
I will answer this question. Okay, untuk for the deposition technique, we just use one-step deposition lah. But normally the engineer use the platinum deposition to hold the sample, to make the sample, and then before do the milling process. And our deposition also have 5 type of materials. We use the platinum, carbon.
Carbon, yeah. Platinum is the most common.
The most common is the platinum. But the other choice is the use the carbon and insulator, and the remaining two I not remember.
Okay.
There are 5 type of the gas injection system to do the deposition process.
Okay.
And then the second question from the Dr. Siti Rahmah. What is the difference between carbon, platinum and tungsten deposition? Advantage and disadvantage.
In my opinion, it's more on sample, the sample itself lah. For example, if your sample consists of carbon, so we should not use carbon deposition lah. So we should use platinum. Or for example, your sample iron, consists of iron. So we know that iron can easily react with carbon to form carbide. So maybe it's not very good choice to use carbon deposition, because when we deposit the carbon, maybe it will form carbide layer lah on the sample. So we need to use different type of element. I think that's why in the FIB we have a few type of deposition element lah. That's the advantage having a lot of different type of element that maybe we need to, how to say, match with our own sample lah, nature.
Okay, okay, thank you, Doctor. Okay, next question from the Shahiraliza. Doctor, my sample is polymer composite. Is it possible to use FIB as a preparation for TEM characterization? Polymer composite.
Polymer composite maybe not suitable, because as I mentioned earlier. But it still depends if you use for example epoxy, which means that have a very high melting point. Maybe you can try to use the FIB, but it still will change the structure of the polymer. Then you won't get a very accurate result lah from the TEM analysis. Actually, I suggest you to use, we have ultramicrotome here in URL, okay? So we have ultramicrotome. I think it's much more simple to use ultramicrotome instead of the FIB. And for ultramicrotome, we can produce, I think, around, Farhana ada tak? I think around 200 to 100 nanometer, so right thickness. So, Farhana, 100 nano or 200 nano?
100 nano.
Oh, 100 nano. So it's almost similar thickness with the standard FIB. So from there, actually, you can get also, you also can get very good TEM analysis lah, or SEM analysis from the ultramicrotome.
Okay. Okay, I think that's all the question.
Okay, so most ada quiz kan ke macam mana? Saya open soalan quiz.
Boleh, kalau jika tak ada lagi soalan daripada audiens atau penonton, doktor boleh proceed untuk soalan quiz lah.
Okay. So this is a quiz prepared for all our audience. Okay. So we have 5 question. Okay. So macam mana Mus? Awak pandai dulu ke? Saya tekan dia punya ni kan. So I think
biasa biar ni kot. Biar dia orang baca kot. And then dia orang boleh jawab.
So audience who know the answer need to write on the chat box lah. Okay. So the first question. Later, I think the moderator will contact you after you answer the question.
Okay.
So first question: what is the function of the blanker in the FIB column? Oh, yang ni saya sebut sekali juga. Tak tahu ada yang perasan ke tak. Okay. This is the first question. What is the function of the blanker in the FIB column? When you answer, just write number one. So which means we know that you answer question number one. Okay, and then question number two: what is the most used material ions for the FIB optics? This one very simple question. And question number three: name two groups of the suitable sample for the FIB. This one also very simple question. And then question number four: name the system that helped to deliver the precursor to support the deposition and etching process in the FIB SEM system. And the final question is: name 3 out of 5 the result of the ion incidence on metal. So this is the 5 question. So please answer the question, and I think later the secretary will contact you lah and give the how to say akan dapat idea. You get that.
Soalan nombor tiga dah ada jawapan. From Siti Zubaidah Muhammad Yusof. And also the question number two. Also they are answer from the Dr. Nur Akmal Fadil. Soalan 145 tu agak ni sikit lah.
Saya buka je lah tengok soalan tu. Mungkin diorang tak perasan. So this is the question.
So, ada tiga lagi soalan yang tak jawab. Doktor boleh display soalan tak? Display soalan je lah. Jawapannya tak ni.
Ni kot sekejap. Okay, ni soalan.
So the question that still not answer is question one. What is the function of blanker in the FIB column? Number two and number three has been answered. And then number four, name the system that help to deliver precursor to support the deposition and etching process in the FIB SEM system. And number five, name 3 out of 5 the result of ion incidence of matter. Okay.
Belanja soalan senang sikit.
Okay. Oh yes, number five. Muhammad Amin have answered the question number five.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
1, 2, 4. Teruskan number one dan number four lah tinggal. Okay, for blanker this one, nak bagi hint ke? Saya tunjuk slide eh.
Boleh tunjuk slide.
For blanker, should be here. Okay. Okay, should be here lah. Okay. So this is the part of the blanker lah. So if the ion beam bombard to this line, saya tak sebut kat sini tadi, saya sebut dekat slide sini tadi rasanya. In the slide. So I mentioned this slide lah. Okay, to reduce sample damage, we need to use ni lah, utilize electron beam. And then if we use ion beam, we need to utilize the beam blanker.
Okay. Using the ion beam instead of the ion beam.
Betul lah tu. Ni dah ada jawab dah nombor satu. Deflect the beam.
Nombor satu, Nurhana Muhammad.
Soalan, okey. Soalan empat ni tadi. Soalan empat is di sini. Okey, ni soalan empat. Buka ni terus dapat jawapan lah. Okey, so
soalan apa?
Okay, so
no correct answer from the for the question number 4.
Okay, so this is the function of the how to deposit the precursor lah by using the gas injection system.
Ada 4 orang ni. Okay. Baiklah. Dan doktor, rasanya tak ada lagi soalan.
Okey, Mus.
Menang, Mus. Umum pemenang.
Okey, okey. Saya akan umumkan pemenang ya. Okey, untuk maklumat saya umumkan sekali lagi. Tiada pemenang untuk jawapan nombor 4. Okey, pemenang untuk jawapan nombor 1 adalah Norhana Muhammad Rashid. Okey. Soalan nombor 1, what is the function of blanker in the FIB column? Okey. Jawapan yang betul adalah daripada Norhana Muhammad Rashid, iaitu to deflect the beam. Okey, soalan nombor 2, what is the most used material ions for the FIB optic? Okey, jawapan yang betul adalah daripada Dr. Nur Akmal Fadil, iaitu gallium. And then the question number 3, name two group of the suitable sample for the FIB. And then the correct answer is from the Siti Zubaidah Muhammad Yusof, stainless steel and also semiconductor. And soalan nombor 4, tiada jawapan yang betul. Dan untuk soalan nombor 5, name 3 out of 5 the result of the ion incident of matter. So jawapan yang betul adalah dari saudara Muhammad Afizal, Muhammad Amin. The answer is part ion, secondary ion and also dislocations. Okay. Nombor 4 tadi tak ada pemenang sebab doktor dah bagi jawapan dulu. Okay. Okay. Tahniah kepada para pemenang. Okay, nanti apa? Para pemenang akan dimaklumkan. Yalah. Jawatan kuasa webinar akan maklumkan apa? Kepada para pemenang nanti akan contact untuk pemberian sagu hati. Okay, tahniah diucapkan sekali lagi kepada para pemenang. Dan juga nampaknya masa sudah menunjukkan pukul 11.45 pagi. So saya ucapkan terima kasih kepada Dr. Mohd Zamri Mohd Yusop di atas perkongsian yang sangat bermanfaat sebentar tadi. Dan saya yakin ramai para penonton yang telah memperoleh sedikit sebanyak tambahan ilmu, terutamanya kepada para pelajar dan penyelidik yang sedang membuat research atau kajian bidang yang sama. Okey, sebelum itu saya ingin mengingatkan semula kepada semua penonton untuk mengisi dan melengkapkan link kehadiran yang telah diberikan bagi melayakkan saudara semua untuk mendapatkan mata CPD dan juga memperoleh ECJ program. Okay, alhamdulillah kita telah sampai ke penghujung sesi. Maka selesai sudah sesi perkongsian webinar Bicara Pakar UIRL 2021 slot keempat pada hari ini. Dan sekiranya tuan-tuan para pelajar atau para penyelidik memerlukan maklumat lebih lanjut atau yang berhasrat untuk menghantar sampel bagi analisis FIB ataupun berkaitan dengan imaging dan mikroskopi, bolehlah saudara melayari laman web UIRL di website www.utm.my/ppmu. Baiklah, saya bagi pihak PPM, bagi pihak PPMU, Jabatan TNCPI dan jawatankuasa webinar Pakar UIRL 2021, kami sekali lagi ingin mengucapkan jutaan terima kasih kepada Dr. Mohd Zamri Mohd Yusop kerana sudi untuk meluangkan masa dan berkongsi ilmu yang sangat bermanfaat untuk para pelajar, penyelidik dan juga para penonton pada sesi webinar hari ini. Dan juga saya ucapkan terima kasih kepada jawatankuasa webinar dan semua penonton yang terus setia menyokong dan menonton sepanjang sesi webinar ini berlangsung. Dan kami juga ingin memohon maaf kiranya terdapat sebarang kekurangan dan juga kelemahan sepanjang sesi webinar ini berlangsung. Sekian, saya ucap terima kasih kepada semua. Jaga diri semua. Okay, semoga kita akan dapat bertemu lagi. InsyaAllah sekiranya ada pada webinar yang akan datang. InsyaAllah, sekian. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.